And welcome to part two of our three-part tutorial on connecting Postman to Xero via OAuth 2. My name is Matt, and in this tutorial, we'll be covering steps 3 through 6 of the Postman tutorial found here on the developer website. Now, in the last video, we registered an app on the My Apps page of the developer website, and we're just going to need to copy a couple of details out of this one here. So let's copy out our redirect URI, client ID, and then also we'll need to generate a secret in a moment. So actually, let's copy out our client ID first. Inside of Postman, you'll want to come up here to the right-hand corner, click on that little environment quick look button, the eyeball, and hit edit. We'll then want to be putting in our client ID into the client ID field, of course. You'll then want to generate a secret. Now, the thing about the client secret is it does leave as soon as you go off the page, and you'll only be shown from there on in the date time that it was generated at. So make sure you copy this as soon as you've generated it. There you go, and I'll just post that into our client ID area. Now, refresh token, access token, and Xero tenant ID, we'll actually generate them with a few calls later on, so we can ignore those three for now. And the next one we'll need is the redirect URI. Now, the redirect URI is, of course, whatever you've set, but this redirect URI has to match exactly what you've got inside of your app. Otherwise, the calls will not work. So, example, if I've got a forward slash in here, but I don't on my app screen, this won't work. Or if I've got some subdomain, you know, like that, it's not going to work. It has to match exactly what you've got inside of your My App screen. Scopes. Now, the scopes are basically keywords that allow you to access certain areas of Xero. A couple of the interesting ones are some like offline access or the OpenID Connect scopes. As a quick explanation, offline access actually allows you to retrieve refresh tokens. The refresh tokens, of course, will be used to refresh your access tokens. OpenID Connect, these three scopes are primarily used for single sign on and single sign up. So if you're interested in them, you can include them. It does add an extra layer of authorization your user has to allow on the authorization screen. However, it's only a single click allow access button. I'm going to include them today just to show you what that screen looks like, but it's no big deal. And then, of course, any other of the scopes that we're needing, just the general accounting API scopes. So if you need to access, say, invoices and my organization settings, of course I'll be using accounting.transactions because it has the invoices endpoint, and then accounting.settings because that has access to the organization endpoint. If for some whatever reason if I only needed to read what my organization settings were, I would just use accounting.settings.read. You don't need to use both the accounting.settings.read variant and the accounting.settings variant. If you need to get and post, just use the accounting.settings. If you only need to read the endpoint you need to call, just use the .read one. Don't use both in combination. Okie dokie. Now, I've already pasted my ones down over here beforehand, just like we've got up here, offline access, OpenID, profile, email, and accounting.transactions. I'm just going to paste them into my scopes area. These are just simply separated by a single space as well. Nothing extra or fancy included in there. And then the last thing that we'll need is a state. I'm just going to use 123. This is whatever you want to set. If you want it to be an ID or anything like that, absolutely fine. Chuck an ID in there. The state is an extra layer of security that we add to the call to say if we get a state that is either non-existent and you have included one, or mismatched to what you initially authorized with, we'll know that that's a illegitimate call and we'll block the call from happening. Okie dokie. So once we've got those details all plugged in, we're good to go. We're going to hit update, close that window, come across to our collection, click on get started, authorization, and then get new access token. Now, my get new access token page will look a little bit different to yours only because I've pre-filled the variables. Now, these variables in orange here, they are literally just pointing at what you've got up in here. So, as an example, redirect URI is, of course, pointing at redirect URI right there, or rather, the other way around. This redirect URI is looking to that, whatever your variable is up in there. auth URL and access token URL, they can both be found over here on the OAuth Flow page of the same OAuth 2 area of the developer center. The first one, the authorization URL, is actually this URL right here up until authorized, so just before the question mark. Everything after the question mark is actually what we're entering into our environment up here and then being generated out of here. So you could really actually just use this URL like that, copy out your client ID out of MyXero and your redirect URI, and then add whatever scopes you want here and state, and then have a perfectly working link. The thing is, you won't be able to get the code out of that then pass on for an access token. Postman actually deals with that step for you, so we won't be covering this exchange the code step in Postman today. If you're doing that in a live environment, you can come over to this OAuth Flow page here and then read about it right here at step 3, exchange the code. Now for the access token URL, it's actually here in part 3. It's right there for you. You can just copy that out and blast it in there. Okie dokie. So once you've got all of those fields matched up correctly, just click request token. You'll be taken to a login screen like this, assuming you've done everything correctly. If you have done something incorrectly, you will hit an error 500. You'll just have to then have your user who you want, who has access to an organization in here, log in. And of course, if you have an authorization code like myself or an authenticator connected, you will have to log in with that. There we go. So as mentioned before, this is just that extra bit of authorization that you have to allow, as we've included the OpenID scopes. It's just asking, this app wants to have access to your basic profile and email address just because you've included the OpenID scopes. So I'm happy with that. I'm just going to click allow access. Then after that, you'll be taken to the app selection screen. Sorry, organization selection screen, sorry. You can then just click this drop down and you'll be shown a list of every organization you have access to. I simply want to connect to Matt's test organization. If you're only able to connect one organization at a time, so if I instead want to click to demo company, I can only do one or the other. However, you can go through this process multiple times to connect up multiple organizations. Uncertified apps will allow you up to 25 organization connections at the beginning. After that, you will have to register with us. So please get in contact with us and we'll happy to guide you through the process. If you need more access within a certain organization, i.e. your user level within that organization isn't high enough, so you're not a standard user or above, you'll be shown what orgs those you need more permissions in are. So I'm just going to click Matt's test org because I want to connect to that one, and then click the connect button. Right. After that, we'll be given our access token, a ID token, and a refresh token. There's a brief explanation of what these are. The access token is what actually allows you access to any one organization. This will give you 30 minutes worth of your app, 30 minutes of access from the grant of the access token. So as of right now, which is, 3:40 in the afternoon, I'll have until 10 past 4. What I'm going to do first is then let's have a little bit more of an explanation, eh? ID token, this is actually because we added the OpenID Connect scopes. We won't be using this today. However, for those of you who are using single sign-on, single sign-up, this may be handy for you to have a look at right here as well. And then also the refresh token. Now, the refresh token is, of course, what actually allows you to refresh your access tokens. Refresh tokens will last for 60 days at a time or until used. They are not infinite, i.e. you can't use that one token multiple times within that 60-day period. It is used for the first time, it is used up. We do, however, allow a 30-minute access period where you can use the same refresh token as many times as you want after the first 30 minutes of its first being used. That's just to help out where, say, you use your refresh token, but then you don't get the response back for whatever weird reason, so you don't actually have the access or refresh token again. you can just make the same call over again with the same refresh token to then get your new refreshed, a new access and refresh token, and then use that the next time you're going on. Okie dokie. So I'm now going to set both my access and refresh token. What we're going to do is highlight the whole thing, right click, press set OAuth 2. Now this will be what, of course, whatever your environment's named up here in the top right. So set OAuth 2, and then come across to access token. I want to do the same thing with refresh token, highlight the whole thing, set OAuth 2, and then except for that one, I just want to hit refresh token. Like I said before, we can ignore ID token. Now once you've done that, you'll have your refresh and access token in the current value. Unfortunately, it needs to be in both the initial and current, and right-clicking and setting as only added to current. If we come across to connections here, you can see it won't work at the moment. But luckily with our refresh token call, we've added a handy little script in here, which will actually, once the call has been made and you refresh your token, fantastic, it will actually add the access token and refresh token, the new one that you've just generated, up into your environment, into both categories for you anyway. So once you've gone through this new access token and you added it for the first time into the current value, just make a refresh call with it and then it'll add it into both for you. Right, that's everything for part two. Stick around for part three, where we're going to be making a couple of our first calls, one to the connections endpoint and then another to invoices. We'll be, we're going to have some fun around that. Stick around.